marketing team. And today I'm going to be doing an introduction on how to leverage native AWS services using VMware Cloud on AWS. So let's get started. So we're going to cover a few things. Then this is the introductory session. There'll be two further sessions in the coming months, which go into a deep dive technical, but this will be a moderate level technical. So we're going to talk about how we link our VMC SDDC, Software Defined Data Center, with an AWS virtual private cloud. We'll talk about the different ways that services can be accessed from your VMware Cloud on AWS instance. Look at some common use cases, why you want to do this. And finally, I'll give you some reference architectures where you can find those and resources for more information. So if you've been following VMware Cloud on AWS, you would have seen this slide many times. Here we show that you might have your data center on-prem. It is linked to your VMware Cloud on AWS instance. And that is a full vSphere environment. It has vSphere for compute, vSAN for storage, NSX for networking. So it looks just like a Cloud Foundation instance that you might have in your own data center. Now, what we're going to focus on today is that little link between VMware Cloud on AWS and the native AWS services. Now, we always talk about those being, you can access them really easy because they're co-resident. So the services and your SDDC instance are in the same availability zone. So it's really fast, it's low latency. But how exactly do we do this? So let's look at how this is going to work. So first, how do we link the two accounts? So the first account you'll have is the one that you create when you sign up for the VMC service. And this is a VMware run account, and it gives you access to all of the vSphere resources. So within that, what you have is full servers. They're i3 metal servers or other kinds of servers. And those servers are single tenant, means all the resources in this account, everything in it is just for you. And we own it and operate it, and we pay for it, and then we bill you back for the services that you use. The second account is one that you will have created earlier, right? This is just a regular AWS customer account. So this is paid directly by the customer, and this is what has the private connectivity to the VMware Cloud SDDC. And this is kind of the focus for this whole presentation. It gives you full access to all the native AWS services that exist within that account. So let's walk through how that happens. So there's you, the customer, and you're going to go to vmc.vmware.com and say, I would like a VMC instance, and here's my size, and here's my details, and the billing mechanisms, and all that. The other thing you will have done is have pre-created an AWS virtual private cloud. So this will be just a regular one that you create using the normal AWS mechanisms. And what will happen is once you create and link those two, it will build a CloudFormation template. Now this is the automation script that will set up all the different kinds of connectivity you need to get started. That will create a cross-account role for identity access and management, and it will create an AWS managed policy, which has the governance rules around the use of this connectivity between the two accounts. Now that AWS managed policy, what it is owned by AWS, it is managed by AWS, so you can see it, but VMware can actually change it. So if we wanted to make a change, and sometimes we have to because we introduce new services, we go through AWS and request that because we have this joint engineering, and then they will make that change to that. So we don't have direct access to that managed policy. Then it will create an SDDC instance. So this is the VMC service. And it will create an IAM user. Now this IAM user is not a manual user like you would be, but it's an automated user. So it uses this cross account role, and it will use that to go and build all the connectivity between these two halves that you'll need to do integrated AWS services. So this is kind of what that would look like. Now, you can see on the left-hand side, we have a number of hosts. Remember, those are full servers from AWS built into a cloud foundation architecture. And connecting each host over onto the AWS account is an ENI, so an Elastic Network Interface. Same thing you use ENIs for everything else, right? That's just a network interface. And between, let's say, look at that host number one, it's connected to an ENI on the AWS side, and it has a route table. That route table will say, how do I get to networks that exist over on the VMware side? Now, because within AWS on the inside, you don't actually run routing protocols. What you do is you use APIs to go and put routes in a route table manually. Well, not manually, automatically. But it's done with APIs. So that IAM role that you saw that was created, that's how we go and make calls to these APIs to create these route tables so it reflects the routes that are on the VMC side. Now, one thing about that route table is that you can see when those routes get created. So if you go into your logs and look at them, you'll see actually, you know, here's the API call that was made to create this route, to create that route. And as the routes get changed on the VMware side, they will be automatically updated on the other side. And you can watch all that happening. So because those are physical hosts, what happens actually if one of those hosts go down? Now, you know, because of the VMC service, that we will automatically go get another host, replace it, and restore your SDDC to the correct state. But temporarily, that host will be gone. So what happens is the primary router into the SDDC moves to another host, and we'll just start using the next ENI. So you see four ENIs there connecting to hosts. Only one of those is active. And if that particular host goes down, we will fail over to another one, and then that will become the active connection. So if you look into your AWS dashboard, you can actually see these interfaces. So you see one that's active down there, it's highlighted in red. And it says VMware VMC interface do not use. Now, you can see it, you can actually manipulate those, but we put do not use because we don't want customers going in and saying, oh, what are these things, and deleting them, because that would break things. So you can actually see those routes, and now you know what they are. They are the automatically created connections from the AWS VPC to the SDDC in the VMware side. So let's talk about how these things get charged as you send traffic between different places. Now, I know this chart looks very complicated, but it is the same principle that you've been using in AWS the whole time. So the important thing is that center part. So you see ENI at 25 gigabits per second. That's that link that we were looking at earlier. And whenever there's traffic between the same availability zone from the VMware VMC side to your customer VPC, that traffic all transfers for free. So you can have very high bandwidth applications that transfer traffic, and there will be no charges for that. However, just like you have with your regular AWS account, as things go out to the internet, so say down to the internet, or out a direct connect link, there's charges for that. Or if you go between one availability zone to another, there's charges for that. That's just the same as it always been. The key thing is you want to exploit this fact that you have free traffic between the AWS side and the VMware side at high speed. That's going to be very low latency, and that's what allows you to build some innovative services. So let's talk about service access models. So of course you could do public access, right? That's just as if you were coming into a service from the internet and nothing would change there. But that's not the most interesting way to use this, right? So the interesting way to use this is private access models. So there's three of them and we'll go into each one. So the first is VPC gateway endpoints. Now, a couple of examples of this are S3 and DynamoDB. Now, what's different about these and why they're called a gateway endpoint is it's a service which is accessible from your VPC, but it doesn't live inside the VPC. So it doesn't sit in the same address space as your EC2 host, for instance. So that means if we want to connect to it, then what we have to do is set up a route to it and do a NAT function. Now, in your console access for your VMC, you'll see that black box in the middle that you know represents it. And there's where you decide what you're going to enable or disable. So if you decide to enable it, you can see that traffic will flow from the router across that 25 gigabit per second link privately to an ENI, and then it will go to the S3 endpoint. Now remember that S3 endpoint doesn't exist in your private address space. So automatically we will set up the NAT rules, which allow that to be found. We will set up the routing rules required to make sure that we can get to that service. And of course you can access this service from, you know, other places also. If you choose to disable this, okay, and you check, you can still get to those services, but you're just going to go out the same path as if you're going to the internet. Now, this is how you would access an S3 service if you were coming from your own private data center, going across the internet, accessing S3 for some reason. It looks the same, but you don't have that privacy. You don't have private address space. You don't have the protection of that link because you're just coming through the internet. So let's look at second point, VPC interface endpoints that are private link powered, right? So private link is a service from Amazon. And private link gives you an encrypted connection for services which exist in the same private address space as your VPC. And most of the AWS services, except those two gateway services we talked about, are like this. So you can get access to all of these services. It looks like that service just resides inside your VPC. And there's also other things. Endpoint services hosted by other AWS accounts. You can access those with private link. AWS Marketplace partner services. You can access those with private link. They all sit in your private address space. And as a general rule, anything which is private link access, you can access from VMC. Now, because these services appear to sit in your private address space of the VPC, there's no NAT function needed to do it. We rely on all the private link facilities to accomplish that all for us. The last private access method are service endpoints within your managed VPC. So an example of this is, say, RDS. So let's imagine you use RDS to create a database on an EC2 instance. Well, that EC2 instance will sit in your private address space. So of course, if one of the machines in your SDDC wants to access that, it will get routed over there, you know, looking up at the route table, hit the ENI, and then get to RDS. Let's look at another example. An Elastic File Store. So this is a file share, you know, either Linux or Windows, that you've created that sits on a server, you know, an EC2 instance. And then it shares out its files and directories to other entities within your VPC. If you want to get access to that, because it's an EC2 instance, it sits in your private address space. You can access it from any of the machines over on the SDDC side, just because it looks like it's in the same address space and you've got a route table to it. So let's look at a couple common use cases. So this would be really one of the most common use cases. If you want to build up a web service, and you can put that in VMC. There, nothing stopping you, works fine. So you would have maybe web front ends, you'd have middleware services, you have databases, you can have the whole thing. So maybe that's something you might want to do if you already had that running in your private data center and you just want to migrate the entire application over to VMC. It can all run there. But because we're actually running in AWS, we can get access to really interesting services that are hard to rebuild on your own. So let's imagine that we want to use an AWS load balancer, an application load balancer, shown in the middle there. And we'll use it to load balance traffic to machines that sit in your VMware SDDC. So those machines have addresses on a subnet. Remember, that subnet gets shared by populating the route tables. And so you would set up your IP target group to just use the addresses of those two machines. And so your application load balancer looks just like you would if you're just load balancing two EC2 instances. Now, you could build a load balancer also in your SDDC, but think of what else you can do. Web application firewall, that's a service you can get from AWS, and it's just designed for handling and filtering this kind of traffic. So let's add that. What about using AWS Shield for DDoS protection? DDoS protection is something that AWS is really good at, and it's hard to build yourself. So now we can say, let's use the services from Amazon that are especially well suited to that kind of cloud, and then we'll use the applications that you've already built and run those in your SDDC. So you kind of get the best of both worlds. So this is really a very common use case. Now, up to now, we've looked at where you have one SDC and you have one VPC. It's just easier to explain things. Rarely in life are things that simple, right? Customers have dozens, hundreds, thousands of VPCs sometimes. And they might have more than one SDDC also. So different groups, different applications, maybe make an SDDC for every type of application. In this case, what you're going to use is a transit gateway. That is shown in the middle there. And it is essentially a virtual router that can route between all of these. Before we supported the transit gateway, what you had to do was make a route, point-to-point route, like a link, VPN link, between everything and everything, which always, is a bit difficult. This simplifies a lot of things. So now you can build really complex applications using multiple VPCs, using multiple SDDCs, lots of services, and can tie that not only to the internet for services for customers, but you can tie into our on-prem SDDC. So this simplifies that. And we'll be covering this also in a more in-depth networking session that is to follow. So where can you get more information? So there is a bunch of reference architectures. Now, this reference architecture, which I'm showing, which you probably can't see, is the one for doing the application load balancing, just like we saw. So it has everything you need to know and how to set it up and detailed diagrams. That link there, that's where you can go get these reference architectures. So that would be the first place to start. If you wanted to build something across these two, go see if there's already a reference architecture in our community section. Next place, we have a channel on YouTube, so you can see videos where people explain different common case studies. That's a good place to go. This link here to the reference architectures is the same ones I just showed you. You can also follow us on Twitter and we will be doing updates. We've also got a blog you can go look at. So as the new things come out, that would be a great place to go. So with that, I hope that helps you understand how to start integrating AWS and VMC to create new innovative services. And we'll be following this up with another one, a deeper dive on networking, and then we'll go to a demo which actually show you how to do this. Thank you for your time. Have a good day.